Well, good morning, and welcome to our service of morning praise this morning. My name is Mary Pilcher Clayton, and I'm a lay worship leader here. You should have a copy of Psalm 111, a hymn book, and an order of service. We're really pleased to have you here with us this morning, and we're going to begin our worship with hymn number 408, Lord Enthroned in Heavenly Splendor. So please stand. Kneel. Lord, we say together, Lord, direct our thoughts and teach us to pray. Lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And today's collect. God of constant mercy, who sent your Son to save us, remind us of your goodness. Increase your grace within us, that our thankfulness may grow, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God our Father, we come to you in sorrow for our sins, for turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives. Father, forgive us. For behaving just as we wish, without thinking of you. Father, forgive us. For failing you by what we do and think and say. Father, forgive us. For letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world about us. Father, forgive us. For living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son. Father, forgive us. May the God of love bring us back to himself. Forgive us our sins and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed is the Lord. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy. We're going to sing again, this time hymn number 382. Let all the world in every corner sing, my God and King. On the sheet that hopefully you were given as you came into church. At the end of the psalm, we will be saying the Gloria, which is printed in the order of service at the bottom of page 2. praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright, in the congregation. Full of honour and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He provides food for those who fear him. He is ever mindful of his covenant. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Andy and Catherine are now going to bring us the readings from the Old and New Testament.
The Old Testament readings from the first book of Kings, chapters 2 and 3. Then David rested with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. He had reigned 40 years over Israel, 7 years in Hebron and 33 in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat on the throne of his father David, and his rule was firmly established. Solomon showed his love for the Lord by walking in according to the instructions given him by his father David, except that he offered sacrifices and burned incense on the high places. The king went to Gibeon to offer sacrifices, for that was the most important high place, and Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon during the night in a dream, and God said, "Ask for whatever you want me to give you." Solomon answered, "You have shown great kindness to your servant, my father David, because he was faithful to you and righteous and upright in heart. You have continued this great kindness to him and have given him a son to sit on his throne this very day. Now, Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. But I am only a little child and do not know how to carry out my duties. Your servant is here among the people you have chosen, a great people, too numerous to count or number. So give your servant a discerning heart to govern your people and to distinguish between right and wrong. For who is able to govern this great people of yours?" The Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for this. So God said to him, "Since you have asked for this, and not for long life or wealth for yourself, nor have asked for the death of your enemies, but for discernment in administering justice." This is the word of the Lord.
The New Testament reading is from the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 5. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to one another, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. We stand to sing our offertory hymn, which is number 630, Tell His Praise in Song and Story.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for the offerings on the plate and via bank transfer. We thank you for the generosity of those who have given and the generosity that you give to us. We pray that you will bless these offerings for the increase of your kingdom. In Jesus' name. Please be seated. So I guess some of you have probably never been to a service led by a lay worship leader before. So this is the point at which I say you don't get a sermon, because lay worship leaders haven't been trained, and so we have been trained for 3 years in theological study, so we don't preach sermons. But we are encouraged to give a talk. I'm not quite sure what the difference is, but hopefully you'll see the difference a bit in what I say today. So this was a fairly late request to do this service, and so I had a look in my online to find out the lectionary and to see what the readings were, and I saw the Old Testament story of Solomon. I thought, well, that's a good one. That's what I'm going to base my talk a bit on. A bit of the backstory first. Just before the passage we read, King David was dying. And there was a power struggle, big time. The heading in my Bible for the section in between, the readings we had actually were slightly split. The heading in my Bible for the section in between our readings from 1 Kings is Solomon consolidates his reign. That's a polite way of saying Solomon had his elder brother, Adonijah, killed and made an alliance with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, by marrying his daughter. His kingdom secure, Solomon goes to Gideon to make a sacrifice, and at night he has a dream. God says to Solomon, "Ask what you want, or ask what I should give you." And Solomon, aware of the challenges ahead, asks for an understanding mind to govern God's people and the ability to discern between good and evil. I've entitled my reflections on this passage, Prayer and Priorities. From my teens, I've been interested in prayer. Not only in praying, but actually, what is prayer? What are the effects of prayer? And evidence of this is one of the oldest books on my bookshelf, priced 30p, which I bought with a book token I won as a prize as a teenager. And it's Prayer by John Bunyan. Yes, he wrote more than The Pilgrim's Progress. He wrote quite a few books as well, or meditations. This was also written in Bedford Jail. And for the bell ringers, the picture on the front has got the bell tower where John Bunyan rang as a bell ringer. So it's not, as I've already said, it's not my place to say what I think. So what I've done this morning is I've got some questions for you to think about. And I'm thinking mainly about asking prayers with these questions. So I'm going to read the questions as a set, and then I'm going to read them again with a gap in between so that you can have a think about them. And maybe think about them later. What does the way you think about prayer say about you? About those you are praying for, and most importantly, about God? That's question one, 3 parts. What is the purpose of prayer? Do prayers always need to be spoken out loud? How is silent prayer different from spoken prayer? are we selfish in our prayers? And finally, a challenge. Are we honest in our prayers? So those questions again. What does the way you think about prayer say about you, those you are praying for, and most importantly, about God? What is the purpose of prayer? Do prayers always need to be spoken out loud? How is silent prayer different from spoken prayer? Are we selfish in our prayers? Are we honest in our prayers? Listen to what John Bunyan has to say about prayer. And he entitled this section, What True Prayer Is. Some of the language is slightly old-fashioned, but I hope it makes sense. Prayer is a sincere, sensible, affectionate pouring out of the heart or soul to God through Christ in the strength and assistance of the Holy Spirit for such things as God has promised or according to his word, for the good of the church, with submission in faith to the will of God. In this description, there are seven things. Prayer is 1, a sincere, 2, a sensible, 3, an affectionate pouring out of the soul to God through Christ, 4, by the strength or assistance of the Spirit, 5, for such things as God has promised or according to his word, 6, for the good of the church, 7, with submission in faith to the will of God. Bunyan then goes on to discuss those 7 points. I'm going to read you the first and the last, and encourage you to get the book and read the rest. If you can't, if it's out of print, which I think is unlikely, you can borrow mine. For the first of these, prayer is a sincere pouring out of the soul to God. Sincerity is such a grace as runs through all the graces of God in us and through all the actings of a Christian and has the sway in them too, or else their actings are not regarded of God. David speaks particularly of sincerity when he mentions prayer. I cried unto him with my mouth and he was extolled with my tongue. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear. Part of the exercise of prayer is sincerity, without which God does not accept it as prayer. Ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. That's from Jeremiah. The want of this made the Lord reject the prayers of those mentioned in Hosea, when he says, they have not cried unto me with their heart, that is, in sincerity, when they howled upon their beds. It is rather for a pretense, for a show in hypocrisy, to be seen of men and applauded for the same that they pray. Sincerity was that which Christ commended in Nathanael when he saw him under the fig tree. Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. Probably Probably this good man was pouring out his soul to God in prayer under the fig tree, and that in a sincere and unfeigned spirit before the Lord. The prayer that has this in it as one of the principal ingredients is the prayer that God regards. Thus the prayer of the upright is his delight. And why must sincerity be one of the essentials of prayer which is accepted by God? Because sincerity carries the soul in all its simplicity to open its heart to God and to tell him the case plainly, without equivocation, to condemn itself plainly without dissembling, to cry to God heartily without complimenting. I have surely heard Ephraim bemoaning himself thus, "Thou hast chastised me, and I was chastised as a bullock unaccustomed to the yoke." Again from Jeremiah. Sincerity is the same in a corner alone as it is before the face of all the world. It knows not how to wear two masks, one for the appearance before men and another for private use. It must have God and be with him in the duty of prayer. It is not a lip labour that it regards for sincerity. Like God, looks at the heart, and that is where prayer comes from, if it be true prayer. And then the section on submitting to the will of God. And because, as I said, prayer submits to the will of God and says, "Thy will be done, as Christ has taught," therefore the people of the Lord, in all humility, are to lay themselves and their prayers and all that they have at the foot of their God, to be disposed of him as he, in his heavenly wisdom, sees best. It's helpful to remember that Bunyan was in prison when he was writing. Yet not doubting God, but God will answer the desire of his people that way that shall be most for their advantage and his glory. When the saints therefore pray with submission to the will of God, it does not argue that they are to doubt or question God's love and kindness to them, but because they are at all times are not so wise, but that sometimes Satan may get advantage of them as to tempt them to pray for that which, if they had it, would neither prove to God's glory nor his people's good. Yet this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hear us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of. That is, we are asking in the spirit of grace and supplication. For as I said before, that petition that is not put up in and through the Spirit is not to be answered, because it is beside the will of God. For the Spirit only knows that, and so consequently knows how to pray according to that will of God. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of a man which is in him? Even so, things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. But more of this hereafter. And then he goes on to talk about prayer in the Spirit. Now, just a couple of paragraphs on priorities, which I felt was the other thing that stood out to me in that passage from Kings. Solomon was challenged to ask what he wanted from God, to name his priorities. If we had Solomon's dream, what would we ask for? That's quite a challenge, isn't it? What we would have asked for: world peace, success in an exam, partner in life. Sometimes we show what is really important to us by the way we use our free time. That's quite a clue to our priorities. What are our priorities? What should they be? As those of you who worship regularly here know, I sometimes lead prayers of intercession. When leading, my aim is to bring us together into the situations we are praying for, to grow empathy with those we are praying for, so that we can pray with intelligence and compassion. Sometimes, as we pray, our focus shifts and we become less selfish, especially when we realise that we're actually called to be part of the answers to our prayers. If we let it, prayer can change our priorities. I'm just going to read you once more those questions about prayer so that you can remember some of them to think of over lunch or over coffee. What does the way you think about prayer say about you, those you're praying for, and most importantly, about God? What is the purpose of prayer? Do prayers always need to be spoken out loud? How is silent prayer different from spoken prayer? Are we selfish? And are we honest in our prayers? Amen. I invite you to stand for our affirmation of faith, which is on page 3 of your order of service. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
So we sit or kneel for our prayers of intercession.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Father God, you are the God of creation. We thank you for your marvelous works. Help us to appreciate the beauty around us and daily give you thanks. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give strength to our bishops, priests, and all who serve your church in any way, especially here in Calne. Bless our work as we seek to create a community and place where everyone feels they belong. We pray for one another, the communities we live in and our loved ones, for those who feel lonely or isolated, for those overwhelmed by the challenges of each day, and for those adapting to new ways of living. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless and guide King Charles and the royal family. Give wisdom to all in authority, guide their decisions, and give them honesty and wisdom to do the best for those they have promised to serve. We pray today for the parts of the world where we know people are being killed, oppressed, or displaced. For the people of Gaza, Ukraine, and Sudan, and those in places we do not hear of. May those in power turn their backs on violence and follow your call to peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We bring before you today, Lord, all young people, for those waiting for exam results, for those whose results may disappoint and will mean a change of plan, for those whose results enable them to look forward to the next stage of their lives, for those caught up or trapped by gang violence and living in fear of being attacked. May they all move forward in their lives and discover your light of love and hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Lord, we share with you our love and concern for people in a dark place and pray that they will find your strength in the love and compassion of those around them. We ask for your blessing on those who endure pain and illness. We especially pray for Brian and Rosemary Hick, Henry Wonham, Deirdre Aldous, Jan Foskett, Simon Marsden, June Haynes, Uda Crook, Pamela Cooper, Herta Buckridge, Nicola Rigby, and those we name quietly in our hearts. May the frightened be surrounded with your tenderness, those in pain be given strength, the weak held in your arms of love, and those recovering be given hope and patience. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We share the grief of people close to us who have lost loved ones. We know your everlasting light shines with us in times of great sadness. We bring before you Constance Wiltshire, Wynne Pierce, and Diana Elliott, who have died recently, and we pray for their families and friends. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the words of Timothy Dudley Smith, who died this week, Lord, for the years your love has kept and guided, urged and inspired us, cheered us on our way, sought us and saved us, pardoned and provided. Lord of the years, we bring our thanks today. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Following the service this morning, tea and coffee will be served at the back, and you'll be very welcome to join us. We now stand to sing our final hymn, number 332, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky.
Thank you.
bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Blessing, honour and glory be yours, here and everywhere, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of God.